invite you to join us for the morning worship service of Trinity on the Hill United Methodist Church. We welcome you as we worship the Lord together.
There's some excitement going on in this worship place today, and you'll be a part of that. We're glad that you're here. Please let us know that you are here. You get an extra crown in your thorn if you sign the registration pad. Let us know that you are here today. It doesn't matter how big the crowd is, the worship of Jesus Christ, especially in this Easter season, is always powerful and important for us to gather together. So as you're signing your registration pads, be sure you say hello to each other. If you can clump up a little bit, that might be helpful as the TV cameras will go down the row and pick up more faces than would. But we are indeed here for the priority of worshiping God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit as we worship Christ in all of His grace and truth. Let's stand together in your call to worship is in your order of worship as we begin our worship service together. Can you see it? The Spirit of God is upon us. Can you hear it? People are crying out for peace. Can you feel it? God's immeasurable greatness of power. Lord, make us ready. Our hymn of praise is number 303, the day of resurrection. Thank you.
Let us join together in our affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed, found in your bulletin. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Be seated as we go into our morning prayer. You'll find our prayer chorus printed in the bulletin. We've been learning this beautiful chorus. It's wonderful for Easter, and we continue, as Mike said, to celebrate the Easter season. Savior, worthy of honor and glory. This kneeling rail is open as always at Trinity if you would like to come spend some time on your knees. I'm going to ask the choir to sing through it once to remind you of the melody, and then you join us the second time.
Amazing God, God of the resurrection, you have brought us through Easter, where we rejoiced at the great good news of the resurrection of Jesus Christ and the reality of the empty tomb, that Jesus died for our sins and he conquered death through your amazing power. We are celebrating this Easter spirit that not just happened on that one day, but continued as you met with your disciples in the upper room, even though they were behind locked doors due to fear and doubt and anxiety. You walked alongside them from day to day, and just do not let us forget the memory of that Easter moment. Don't let it fade in our hearts and our minds, but every Sunday and every day, may we be reminded of this great victory of yours on Easter. Holy God, help us to make the space for you in our own lives, in our everyday living. Help us to find a room for your love and presence where we work and where we live and in our schools, and most importantly, in those places that we have tried to hide from you, in those dark corners of our own lives. We know that you're always chasing us, hounding us, So we just pray that we would be humble enough and brave enough and faithful enough to let you come in into our lives. We know without question that you come to us in our everyday lives, but we know we must ask forgiveness because we know that we're not always ready for you to be with us, and we're not always seeing where you are in our lives. So forgive us when we doubt your presence. We confess that we let so many things crowd into our lives, and too often we let these distractions blur out our awareness of your presence. So through your Holy Spirit, let us see the risen Christ, and let us have the assurance of your love and presence with us. Always remind us to stand up and to rejoice in this fact, not just on a worship day, but every day. And so as we come to you, amazing God, with all of our fears and doubts, with our joys and sorrows, with our longings and dreams, we come to ask you to heal us and to fix us where we're broken in our souls and in our minds. We bring all these things to you in the hope that you will hear our prayers and respond to our cries, praying that you would peel away the scar tissue that we've allowed to build up in our hearts. And as we pray for ourselves, we also bring to our prayers those people that we love so much, for whom there are still issues of loneliness and pain, suffering and grief, and a sense of loss. And along with those that we love, we also pray for those that we do not know, especially for our brothers and sisters in Christ around this world who are persecuted for their beliefs, who are not able to worship openly and freely, who risk life to lift up the name of Jesus Christ. At the same time, we raise to you those who have rejoiced in a newfound faith in this Easter season. We rejoice with those who have found reconciliation with loved ones. We rejoice with those who have survived tragedy and sorrow and who have the presence of Christ in their hearts and lives. And now, as your Easter people, we pray the prayer which he taught us to live and to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our hymn is one of our favorites, especially this time of year, number 364, Because He Lives. Let's stand as we sing.
Thank you.
As our children come down, greet each other in the name of the risen Christ.
Hi, I just wanted to welcome you to the worship service of Trinity on the Hill United Methodist Church. We are glad that you are joining us this morning as we worship Jesus Christ, full of grace and truth. If you're catching us on YouTube because you're not here this morning, we welcome you back to our worship service and look forward to seeing you next week. I hope all of you can come and be with us. We have a pew waiting for you and would love to have that fellowship in Jesus Christ. God bless you.
Have a seat right there. Thanks. Yeah. Yeah. Wow. Today I didn't think I'm not ready. I didn't think there'd be a lot of children here today and for a message. But wait a minute. I should have done a few things ahead of time, but I forgot. Let me see if it's still up. Oh yeah, here it is. Okay, I got it. I was gonna make for you something before you came, because I didn't think you'd be here. But here you are. Wow, that's great. Oh, let's see. My instructions. Oh, here they are. Good. All right. See, I'll need you just to hold those so I can read them, all right? A little further away. Good. All right. That's great. All right. Let's see, fold. I should have been ready. I should have done this ahead of time. Okay, well, fold this in a triangle like you're diapering a baby. I haven't done that in a long time. For me, no, don't, it gives away the secret, yeah, okay, before I put the corners in the, can you hold it a little bit where I can, yeah, see, I just wasn't ready to do this. All right, put these into, and roll this up halfway loosely, loosely, all right, I forgot the loosely part, all right, okay, now fold the bottoms, top, oh, I should have been ready, I'm so sorry, I should have had this done ahead of time. All right, see, where I can see it, I can't see it, there you go, yeah, all right, fold the bottoms a third across, all right, pull this back, I'm just wasn't ready to do this, all right, pull this back and tuck, I wish there were pictures, it'd be a lot easier, all right, tuck that in, like, see, what this is going to be, I should have told you how, this is going to be a jumping bunny. I don't know. See, I was supposed to do it ahead of time to make sure it works. But anyway, let's see, where was I? All right, so this jumping bunny says one ear should start to appear. All right, there's one ear. Okay, good. And then it says the other ear. Oh, well, that sort of looks like a bunny. Maybe we could put a tail up like that and maybe do the ears. But it's supposed to do something very special if you folded it right. What? What? Oh, is that what you're supposed to do? Okay. It's a wonderful jumping bunny is what the instructions say, to make a wonderful jumping bunny. It's not jumping. What? You're supposed to pat the wonderful jumping bunny. Okay, here we go. You ready? I don't know if it's going to work or not, because I was supposed to do it ahead of time, and I wasn't ready to do it. So here we go. All right, ready? Pat it. Pat. You want to pat it? I'm a little afraid to pat. All right, I'll do it. I'll do it. I'll do it. All right, here we go. Whoa! How'd that happen? Here. Let me see those instructions. What'd we put in there? Hold on. Let's. Oh! Look at that bunny. That bunny is jumping. Look at that. Whoa! Oh, my goodness. Wow. Well, whew. I'm sorry I took all that extra time and I wasn't ready. We probably could have had a lot more time to play with the wonderful jumping bunny, but you're really involved in those instructions, aren't you? Yeah, me too. See, the story here is that we need to be ready. You know, we need to be prepared to do some things, especially if God has some good works for us to do. We got to read the instructions ahead of time. And our instructions as a Christian is what? The Bible. We look at the Bible, we look at the Word of God, look at those around us who are Christians that teach us the good things to do. And then we'll be ready to do the work that we were supposed to do when we finally got it done. We finally got to see the bunny, but it took a while, didn't it? Okay. All right, let's pray. God, thank you so much for what you do for us and what you allow us to do. Hold us close to your heart that we can do good works in your name. But most of all, and most importantly, help us to be ready. Help us to be work ahead of time to expect those people to see your witness in us. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, hold that end real tight. Real tight. That end. The end right, real tight. Ah, back to the clip. All right, there we go.
I'm impressed that Lillian and Mike can sit on the floor. I could sit down on the floor. I just wouldn't be able to get up. Good for you. At the church I worked in before I came here, I was a director of stewardship, which basically is a glorified term for meaning fundraiser. And our senior minister used to say often, he said, there are only two kind of churches, those who have fundraisers and those who wish they did. And when I was working there, I worked there for 9 years, and I asked many people for large gifts to the church or to give to the church. And when I first started doing that, it was not an easy task. I didn't think I was going to like it very much. And one day I received a note in the mail that I've saved to this day, never forgotten. It was a thank you note from one of the people that I worked with and talked to about giving to the church. And he said, you know, I've been giving to the church all of my life, but I've never given with joy. And you taught me how to give with joy. And he said, it totally changed my life. And I thought, wow, what a great perspective. If we can just learn not just to give, but to give with joy. And realize that when we give, we're not just impacting lives in this church, but we're literally touching lives all over the world. When we do that, I promise you, it'll bring joy into our lives. Let us pray together as our ushers come. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that when we give, that we can experience great joy, knowing that our gifts are used to bless so many people and to bring people into your kingdom, and to help those who are in trouble, and just to touch lives in so many ways. Bless these gifts, and bless those who give them. And these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Last Sunday, we sang this beautiful hymn, number 314. And you might want to refer to the text. It's that wonderful hymn, In the Garden. And Lisa and Andy wowed us at the early service with this beautiful arrangement. So just sit and soak in this beautiful song and this beautiful arrangement.
It's always a joy to be able to share part of the family with you and to be here today and to sing. Aaron, this is Aaron, in case you're wondering. This is Aaron. And we've looked at a couple of songs to do. She chose this first one, which it needs really no explanation, but a little bit of embellishment helps a little bit. With this young boy goes and picks some flowers for his mom and the roses, and he gets thorns in his hands. And he relates that to Jesus' pain and suffering, and then a little surprise ending at the end. So, the hand song.
Draw me close to you. What a blessing. Let's stand for the reading of God's holy word. This comes from Titus, the third chapter, third and final chapter of Titus, starting with the first verse. It says this: remind them to be subject to rulers and authorities, to be obedient, to be ready for every good work, to speak evil of no one, to avoid quarreling, to be gentle, and to show every courtesy to everyone. For we ourselves were once foolish, disobedient, led astray, slaves to various passions and pleasures, passing our days in malice and envy, despicable, hating one another. But when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, He saved us, not because of any works of righteousness that we had done, but according to His mercy, through the water of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit. And listen to this part. The Spirit poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that, having been justified by His grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. And what a great hope that is. This is the Word of God for us, the people of God. And we say, you may be seated. Charles T. Studd, I don't know if that's a familiar name with any of you all, but back in the 1900s, early 1900s, he wrote a poem. Probably the couplet that ends each stanza, probably most familiar to everyone if you've seen it maybe on a plaque or something, but it's a rather lengthy poem that basically came after his conversion. It was an expression of his conversion before his life and after his life. I don't want to read the whole poem to you today. Maybe you can find that and read it for yourself. But I want to do two stanzas and notice those couplets that happen after each stanza. Give me, Father, a purpose deep, in joy or sorrow, Thy word to keep, faithful and true, whate'er the strife, pleasing Thee in my daily life. Only one life, 'twill soon pass. What's done for Christ will always last. Oh, let my love with fervor burn, and from the world now let me turn, living for Thee and Thee alone, bringing Thee pleasure on Thy throne. Only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Now, a sketch of C.T.'s life is very interesting. He was the cricketer. He played cricket. That was his big objective in life. He enjoyed doing that. He was born and raised in England. That's a popular game in England. And as you know, mimics our American baseball. It's a ball and bat type of game. I've never played it myself, but it looks interesting when you watch it. He was brought out of that career by a very interesting set of circumstances that basically came through the conversion of his wealthy father, Edward. You see, Edward attended a campaign. You know, when they're called revivals, were called campaigns a while back, or you know, just services together. And Dwight L. Moody, an American evangelist, came and led that campaign in England. And Edward, Charles's father, went and through that service, through that series of services, he found the Lord. He was saved. And he became a new person, a new creature in Christ, as normally happens. So Edward's home now became kind of a hub of activity for all kinds of visiting pastors that would come and stay with them in that house while they did their campaigns there in England. Charles was there as well, son Charles, the one who wrote the poem just a moment ago. But one unnamed preacher that was staying there one evening, maybe for a set of evenings, pressed Charles with this question. The question is this, very simple. Do you believe in God's promises? Do you believe in God's promises? Well, this is a person that's been around this new life and his father's conversion. And it's very interesting that this visiting preacher would press him with this question. Do you believe in God's promises? Well, the preacher didn't like the first answer that Charles gave, and he pressed a little further. And pretty soon it came to be very evident that Charles had never confessed with his lips or with his life, his love in Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. These are the words that Charles said as he explains that conversion experience for himself. I got down on my knees and I did say thank you to God. And right then and there, joy and peace came into my soul. I knew then what it was to be born again. And listen to this. And the Bible, which had been so dry before, became everything. Friends, this doesn't just happen. Are we ready to do good works? From there, he did work in China, Africa. He founded an evangelistic organization that went through several names, but it is called today World Evangelization for Christ. It's a very successful organization, and its thrust is solely reaching those who have never been reached for Jesus. So they're planting churches, planting missionaries in places where the gospel has never been preached. Very successful. You know, I long for stories like that today. I long for hearing about the reaching those who have never heard about Jesus, or people finding that conversion experience that may have been in a church for a long time, or even sat before preaching or teaching, but never really accepted Christ in their own life. And that does happen, that does exist. But I long for stories like that. I want to hear more. What moves me in stories like this and others is the readiness of those who are doing God's work. And that's the question we're asking ourselves today. Are we ready to do good works? The wonderful miracle does not just happen. The wonderful example that we have before us doesn't just appear, but it's put in place by those who are ready to do the work of God. It's a product of people being ready and listening when God directs. People who don't mind a thorn in their hands here and there to do the work of God. Those who aren't worried about ridicule or being alone or isolated because of how they believe or how they feel. But people who want to make sure good works are done. Ready to do those good works. These things don't just happen. Are we ready? Titus, the book we read from today, is a little bitty book, rather small, just 3 chapters. It was a letter of Paul to Titus. He was a very important person to Paul. The thing about Titus and 1 and 2 Timothy and Philemon and maybe some others is that they are called pastoral epistles. What that means is they are generated to the leaders of the church to encourage them to teach the right things and to keep the main thing the main thing. Keep going on in good works. Usually you'll find some instruction like we read today. Some things that are very, very important for us and certainly do apply to our lives. Today's scripture, for instance, has several phrases of instruction as you would find in a pastoral epistle. Seven phrases, to be exact, that may make you think Paul knows something's going on within the church and Titus needs a little help with that. It starts out saying, remind them. We need to be reminded, don't we? Y'all keep a calendar? Yeah, we keep a calendar and we keep birth dates and anniversaries, hopefully, and other things on there that are very, very important to us. My calendar actually sends me a text message when I have an appointment coming up. I can tell it to send it to me an hour ahead or half hour ahead, and it does, and it's marvelous. And I depend on that. Sometimes I depend on that a little too much. But it's amazing. You know, we want to be reminded. We need to be reminded. And he's telling them, remind them to be subject to rulers and authorities, to be obedient. How important is that? And the one we want to look at today, to be ready for every good work, to speak evil of no one, to avoid quarreling, to be gentle, and to show every courtesy to everyone. That's a pretty good list. That's a list, I think, that we might be able to live with, or at least have some gumption to fulfill those desires. For the writer of this book, however, it wasn't always that way for Paul. These phrases come out of a complete conversion because he was anything but that before his life in Christ. That one sentence with seven phrases were, before his encounter with Christ, things to be scoffed at, because they were workings and they were characteristics of people of the way, of Christians, those Christ followers. Oh yeah, he took authority, but he took authority to make sure as many of them died as he could see die. And he was obedient to his own will of ridding the world of these heathen Christ followers. He was misguided for what he thought was good works, going with papers in hand to do the work that he did, which was terrible. And he could not speak enough evil against these Christians. They were good for nothing but the torches that would light the way to the Colosseums. He didn't like us. He didn't like people of the way. We won't go into a lot of detail about that conversion experience of Saul, now Paul, but you remember it as the story of the Damascus Road experience where he met the Lord while he was on the way to slaughter Christians, people of the way. Now, however, now something wonderful has happened. God has started a work in Saul, changed his name to Paul because of that, and now we see him as teacher, preacher, writer, evangelist, follower of Christ, Christian. This doesn't just happen. Are we ready to do good works? The scripture teaches that for us today. Now, it makes me want to ask, what are those things that got Paul ready? Well, how did he get ready? Well, one thing, I think, is he knows who he is in Christ. He knows who he is in Christ, his purpose. As the poem we read a moment ago, CT is saying, give me a purpose in life. Teach it to me, O Lord. Anything that's worth living for, that which lasts is of Christ. So he knows who he is in Christ. He knows his subject. My goodness, I don't have to read too many of Paul's writings to realize he knows what's going on, and he is committed. He has purpose in life. He knows who he is. He knows his subject. He is committed. He knows who he is in Christ. In that same verse, he lists what he used to be, what he happened to be. He reminded the people of that. You remember it? He says, we ourselves were once foolish, disobedient, led astray, slaves to various passions and pleasures, passing our days in malice and envy, despicable, hating one another. That's not a nice list. That's a naughty list. That's terrible stuff. But he remembered what it was like being that way. He remembered what it was like to not love as he should have been loving and caring as he should have been caring. But something wonderful happened. I have been changed, Paul would say. I am a new person in Christ. And because of that change, I am committed to doing good works. I am encouraging others to do good works. It is an intricate part of every Christian and every church to do good works. And oh, that beautiful turn verse, it says, but when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us according to his mercy. Floyd, he saved us according to his mercy. Don't you get overwhelmed at God's mercy? Coming through the Easter season and still in the Easter season, it's most prevalent to us, God's unobtainable, undeniable mercy for us if we tried to pay for it or speak enough for it or do enough things. But we can. It's given to us freely because God loves us. Aren't you overwhelmed by that when you consider God's mercy? Not getting what we deserve, but by his grace, he gives us the very best, though there's nothing we can do to attain it except say yes. Oh, yes, Lord. He completely emptied himself so that we can be full and live joyful service, live in joyful service to him. Don't you get overwhelmed at that? God's mercy. I used to love to hear Billy Graham just simply say, God loves you. Oh man, he would say it like no one else. God loves you. And he wants a life with you. He wants a relationship with you. Well, he knows who he is by just looking at some of the opening letters. Romans says, Paul, a servant of Christ. 1 Corinthians, Paul, called to be an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God. 2 Corinthians starts out, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God. Galatians, Paul, an apostle, sent not from man nor by man, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him from the dead. Philemon says, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus. No doubt he knows his calling and who he is. This doesn't just happen. Are we ready to do good works, church? We also find a person who knows this subject. I know whom I have believed, Paul writes, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed to him until that day. You can't really write something like that when you don't understand your subject. You remember being in class when you'd done your homework, you read what you're supposed to read, you kind of prepared, and you were all ready. And any question you think that could come your way, you were, oh, I've got the answer to that one. It felt so good. It was a good feeling when you're able to be there and prepared. But all those times you aren't prepared. And it was a long night before, and there are other things going on, and you couldn't get to the assignments before. You kind of slink down in your seat and hope, don't call on me. It feels very, very uncomfortable. Maybe some of you weren't like, I was certainly like that, you know, spent four of my best years as a freshman because of that. But anyway, now tease, it's only two. But anyway, it's a good feeling when you know your subject. You know, I was walking to the tennis court the other day with a friend. We're getting ready to play tennis together. And we were in a conversation. I forget what the conversation was like, but he abruptly stopped the conversation. And I really thought, you know, something's going on. You know, going through all those first aid things in your mind, arm, face, would take some time. But he was caught up by something up in a tree. And he looked up in the tree. And then he looked down at the ground. And then he looked up in the tree again. And he looked back down at the ground. And then he kind of mumbled something. I wasn't quite sure what it was at first, because I had to ask him. But this is what he was saying. He's saying, "I think a cedar waxwing has been here." I didn't know to run, you know, go back to the car, go home. What in the world does that mean? I asked him, I said, "What?" He goes, "I think a cedar waxwing has been here." I know that's not a cedar tree, and I know what wax and wings are, but what are you talking about? He goes, "It's a bird. It's a bird, a cedar waxwing. It's like we've been in the presence of greatness." You know, he was so caught up, and he could tell by something up there and something down there that a cedar waxwing had probably been around. Well, for the next 5 minutes, I got a lecture on how wonderful cedar waxwings are and what a great bird they are and what they sound like and what they do and their migration characteristics and on and on and on and on. He knew cedar waxwings. I didn't know in the world what it was. I went home, looked it up on the internet, and it is actually a beautiful bird. But to see him so caught up and to speak so freely about something that he so desperately loved and cared for, it was almost like a long-lost friend had finally arrived, the cedar waxwing. You know, if we could only speak as freely and as quickly about our love in Jesus Christ, interrupting any conversation that doesn't really matter to a conversation that does matter, sharing with people what we have found in our lives because of our love in Jesus Christ, oh my goodness, we see a big change in this world. This sort of thing doesn't just happen, though. Are we ready to do good works? So he knew who he was in Christ. Paul knew who he was. He knew his subject. And then he was committed to the cause. Look at his life. Because he loved Christ more than anything else, stoned, beaten, left for dead on the outskirts of the city, but he revived, came back to do more work. Ridiculed, put in prison, still he remains steadfast to do good works. He writes this in 1 Corinthians. "Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain." He writes this in Galatians. "Let us not become weary in doing good. Let us not become weary in doing good. For at the proper time we will reap harvest if we do not give up." 2 Timothy, "Do your best. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who does not need to be ashamed and who would correctly handle the word of truth." This doesn't just happen, my brothers and sisters in Christ. Are we ready to do good works? Commitment, knowing your subject, knowing who you are in Christ. Let us pray.
This has been the worship service from Trinity on the Hill, United Methodist Church, a production of Trinity Methodist Television, as an outreach ministry to those of the Augusta area. If you found this to be a meaningful service, let us hear from you by calling 738-8822 or writing Trinity on the Hill, 1330 Montesano Avenue, Augusta, Georgia, 30904.